मॉर्निंग माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, माय सेल्फ महेश बीकूट, वेलकम टू तेनाली पाठशाला। एज यू नो ऑलरेडी वी हैव स्टार्टेड द चैप्टर कॉल्ड सॉलिड स्टेट एंड दिस मे बी आई थिंक लास्ट वीडियो ऑन द सॉलिड स्टेट। सो इन द प्रीवियस वीडियोस इफ यू आर नॉट सीन द लिंक इज गिवन इन द डिस्क्रिप्शन, प्लीज गो थ्रू दैट लिंक एंड सी द वीडियोस फर्स्ट। सो इन टुडेज क्लास वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस रिगार्डिंग इलेक्ट्रिकल प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ सॉलिड्स। So by looking at the name electrical properties, what comes in your mind? Electrical properties means to conduct electricity, what should they do? They should require, they must get some free electrons so that electron can move in one direction, in opposite direction current will move. You know, you have studied in the physics. Yes, so to conduct electricity the metal or the solids must possess electrons, that too free electrons, unpaired electron what we can call. So if the electrons are present they conduct electricity. So depending upon that property solids are classified into three categories. What are those? Yes, conductors, insulators and semiconductors. So depending upon the electrical property solids are classified into three categories. First one, conductors. Yes, next one, semiconductors, last one insulators. See, conductors means what? Conduct electricity. Then what about semiconductors? They also conduct electricity. What about insulators? Insulators does not conduct electricity. That means insulator does not allow to current to pass through it. So then what about conductors? These three, whatever the classification we are discussing, depending upon what? Depending upon the electrical properties. How can you differentiate them? See, conductors are the solids which have conductivity, high conductivity ranging from 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 7 per ohm per meter. So this much, whatever the conductivity value you are having, so those are called conductors, the solids whose highly conductivity ranging between 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 7 per ohm per meter are called conductors. Then what about insulators? Insulators are does not conduct electricity. So those solids who have the conductivity value from 10 to the power minus 10 to 10 to the power minus 20 per ohm per meter, so such a solids are called insulators. Then what about semiconductors? Semiconductors are the solid whose conductivity ranging between conductors and insulator, whatever the conductivity is there, no, those solids are called semiconductors. See here 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 7, here 10 to the power minus 10 to 10 to the power minus 20, here 10 to the power minus 6 to 10 to the power 4 per ohm per meter. So the conductivity, the solids whose conductivity is moderate means in between insulators and conductors, moderate ranging from 10 to the power minus 6 to 10 to the power 4 per ohm per meter are called insulators. I hope you got the points here. Electrical properties, depending upon electrical property solids are classified into three types: conductors, insulators and semiconductors. What about conductors? Conductors are the solids whose conductivity is ranging from 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 7 per ohm per meter. Per ohm per meter means that is unit of conductivity. So this is highly conductivity in case of conductors. And the solids whose conductivity is very low, ranging from 10 to the power minus 10 to 10 to the power minus 20 per ohm per meter, those are called insulators. And the solid whose conductivity is moderate means in between conductors and insulator, moderate conductivity, very low conductivity, so those are called semiconductors whose conductivity is ranging from 10 to the power minus 6 to 10 to the power 4 per ohm per meter. So these are called semiconductors. Can you give an example of conductors now? You know, already studied in the first PUC for a conductor, all metal comes here, almost all metals like yes, silver, Az, yes, aluminium, copper, iron, etc. What about semiconductors? Semiconductors means in between conductors and insulator. There's conductivity is in between semiconductors and insulator. So those solids are called semiconductor. So what are those? So example is germanium, yes, silicon. These are example for semiconductors. Then what about insulators? Wood, rubber, yes, these all comes under stone, whatever. Wood and rubber. These are insulators. In wood and rubber, electricity does not pass, because in wood and rubber there is no free electrons. Therefore, insulators does not conduct electricity. That means they do not allow the electricity to pass through it. But in conductors, yes, they have a free electron, they have a high conductivity, they can easily flow an electron, therefore they conduct electricity. Therefore, conductors allow electricity to pass through it. What about semiconductors? Semiconductors also allow the electricity to pass through it, but less than that of conductors, greater than that of insulators. That's it. So this is between, depending upon electrical properties, solids are classified into three categories. I hope you got the points here. Now we'll discuss band theory of solids. Guys, band theory of solids. What is band theory? Band theory of semiconductors you can take. What is band theory then? Band theory is nothing but, see here, if you take a silicon, yes, what is the electronic configuration? 1s2, 2s2, yes, 2p6, 10 is over now, 3s2, 3p2, 3d, nothing is there. So atomic number is 14. Silicon atomic number is 14, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 6, 2, 8, 10, 12, 14. So these 3D electrons are empty. So let us leave as it is. So now what about these? These are called valence cells. What these are called, guys? These are called valence cell. 3s and 3p valence cell orbitals, atomic orbitals have very lesser, closer energy, so that they can overlap one another. They can combine one another and form two bands. Yes, valence orbitals, valence cells combines to form two energy band. One is conduction band, another one is valence band. See here, the valence orbitals will form two energy band. One is valence band, another one is conduction band. Okay, so atomic orbitals or valence orbitals combine to form two energy band. One is valence band, another one is conduction band. Both the bands have very closer energy to each other, but in valence band electrons are partially filled or completely filled, but in conduction band it is empty. Valence band is highest occupied electronic orbital, and here lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, what we can say. So conduction band and valence band are formed by combination of this valence orbital or atomic orbital. That means we can say atomic orbitals combines to form molecular orbitals having nearly equal energy, and those energy gap between those orbitals are very closer. Therefore, those are called valence band and conduction band. Nothing but molecular orbitals. Yes. So valence band is, yes, highest occupied molecular orbital. Yes. Highest occupied molecular orbital is also called valence band. Lowest unoccupied molecular orbital is called conduction band. That means in valence band electrons are filled, in conduction band electrons are not filled, those are empty. Yes. Now we will see what happens in conductors, what happens in semiconductor, and what happens in insulator. Depending upon band theory, we will discuss now. What is band theory you got? I think so. Is it? So what is that? Valence orbitals or atomic orbitals combine to form nearly equal amount of energy having molecular orbitals. Those molecular orbitals are same that of the atomic orbitals number, and also having nearly equal energy. So those will form two band, energy band. One is valence band, another one is conduction band. Valence band is nothing but highest occupied molecular orbital. What is occupied here? Electrons are occupied. What about conduction band? Conduction band is lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. That is called a conduction band. I hope you got the points here. So depending upon these two bands, we will discuss one by one solids, liquids, and conductors, semiconductors, and insulators. So let us study now. Conductors, what happens? Semiconductors and insulators. See, in conductors, what happens? So let us say this is our which band? Conduction band. Okay. And this is valence band. Okay. Valence band having electrons, highly occupied electrons. Conduction band is empty. Energy gap between conduction band and valence band is called forbidden energy gap. Is called what? Forbidden energy gap. Yes, this one. Then, in case of conductor, this gap is called forbidden energy gap, forbidden zone, you can say now. When in conductors, both the valence band and conduction band are overlapping, like this. These are overlapped, right? So, like this. In conductors, valence band and conduction band are overlapping one another so that electron can easily move from valence band to conduction band. Easily, no gap is there in between valence band and conduction band. Easily, electrons can move. Right? Therefore, they conduct electricity. But in case of semiconductors, so the energy gap is somewhat more. See here, this is conduction band. This is valence band. Okay, there is small energy gap. What there is? Small energy gap. So due to small energy gap, so no doubt here also electron can jump from, here electrons are present, right? In valence band. Electron can move from, valence band to conduction band. Therefore, these also conduct electricity. Energy gap is very small. Therefore, electron can jump from valence band to conduction band. Therefore, they can also conduct electricity. But in insulators, see here, in insulator, conduction band and valence band. Here. See this energy gap. The gap is very large. Therefore, here in semiconductor, gap is very small. Here, no gap at all. That means energy gap is very large. Therefore, in case of insulator, electron cannot jump from. They will not jump from valence band to conduction band. Why, guys? Because of larger energy gap. Larger forbidden energy gap. Therefore, insulator does not conduct electricity. Semiconductor conduct electricity, but to small extent. Conductors highly conduct electricity. I hope you got the points here. So here, forbidden energy gap, FJ I will write, forbidden this gap, difference between, energy difference between conduction band and valence band is called what? Forbidden energy gap, remember that. So forbidden energy gap is zero in case of conductors. And in case of semiconductor, forbidden energy gap is, less than or equal to 3 EV. EV means electronic volt, okay. Then what about this? Insulator, in insulator, the energy gap is very large. So, therefore, forbidden energy gap is greater than 5 EV electronic volt. Here, forbidden energy gap is very zero because overlapping one by one. Here, small energy gap, therefore, less than or equal to 3 EV. Here, very large energy gap, that is greater than 5 EV. EV means electronic volt. Remember, one electronic volt is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. Yes, 1 EV is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. That is the energy gap. Yes, less than 3 EV means you can multiply 3 into this one, you can get in joules. 5 into this one, you can get the in joules. I hope you got the points here. So, what is the band theory then? Band theory is nothing but valence orbitals or atomic orbitals combines to form molecular orbital having nearly equal energy and same number. Those molecular orbitals are a very close energy. They have a very closer energy. Therefore, they can form two energy bands. What are those? Valence band, conduction band. Valence band is nothing but highest occupied molecular orbitals are called valence bands. And lowest unoccupied, not electrons are not occupied there. So, lowest unoccupied molecular orbitals are called conduction band. So, in conductor, valence band and conduction band overlap. Therefore, forbidden energy gap is zero. What is forbidden energy gap? Forbidden energy gap is the difference in energy between valence band and conduction band. Between conduction band and valence band, whatever the energy gap is there, here like this. Whatever energy gap is there, those energy gap is called forbidden energy gap. In conductors, both are overlapping, conduction band and valence band. Therefore, forbidden energy gap is zero. In semiconductor, there is a small energy gap. Therefore, that is nearly equal to, less than or equal to 3 electronic volt. And in insulator, conduction band and valence band are very far apart so that the energy gap is very more. So, therefore, forbidden energy gap is greater than 5 eV. Here, overlapping, electron can easily jump from valence band to conduction band. Electron can move easily conduct electricity. Semiconductor, small energy gap, electron can jump from valence band to conduction band. They also conduct electricity compared to conductors somewhat less. What about insulator? Energy gap is very more. Electron cannot jump from valence band to conduction band. Very difficult to jump. Therefore, insulator does not conduct electricity. What is forbidden energy gap? Greater than 5 electronic volt. 5 EV means greater than 5 electronic volt. I hope you got the points here. This is band theory of solids. Conductors, semiconductors and insulators. Now we will discuss two parts left now. Now we will discuss regarding types of semiconductors, that to extrinsic and intrinsic. And again in extrinsic semiconductor, two types are there. N-type semiconductor, P-type semiconductor. That is also a very important point regarding your forever annual examination. And last one concept, that is magnetic properties of solids. That we will discuss in the next class. Okay. Now today's class we will discuss regarding, yes, types of semiconductors. Let us start now. See here guys, types of semiconductors. So depending upon the semiconductivity, how they are getting the semiconductivity, depending upon that, solids, semiconductors are classified into two categories. Intrinsic semiconductor and extrinsic semiconductors. What is intrinsic semiconductors? Intrinsic semiconductors are nothing but, see, semiconductivity exhibited by solids, semiconductivity exhibited by solids due to pure semiconductor are called intrinsic semiconductivity, and the materials are called intrinsic semiconductors. Yes, due to pure semiconductor, due to pure semiconductivity exhibited by solids due to pure semiconductor is called intrinsic semiconductivity, and the material is called intrinsic semiconductor. What about here? Extrinsic semiconductors or semiconductivity is nothing but semiconductivity exhibited by solids by adding some impurities. Semiconductivity exhibited by solids by adding some impurity to it. So due to that, whatever semiconductivity is observed, that is called extrinsic semiconductivity, and the material is called extrinsic semiconductors. Due to what? Due to adding some impurity. Adding some, yes, impurity. I hope you got the points here. Intrinsic semiconductors are nothing but the material or the solids whose semiconductivity is exhibited by pure substance, pure solids. So those are called intrinsic semiconductivity, and the material is called intrinsic semiconductors. What about extrinsic? Extrinsic semiconductors are the material whose semiconductivity is exhibited by adding some impurities. Adding some impurities. So due to that, whatever the semiconductivity exhibited, that is called extrinsic semiconductivity, and the material is called extrinsic semiconductors. Example for intrinsic semiconductor is silicon and germanium. Silicon and germanium are a better example for intrinsic semiconductors. And in extrinsic semiconductor, the silicon and germanium, along with that, some impurities like phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, boron, whatever you can add. So, silicon with some phosphorus impurity, silicon with some boron impurity. So, these are called impurities, phosphorus and boron. This is intrinsic semiconductor. So, to intrinsic semiconductor, we are adding some impurities so that we can get more conductivity. That means we can say extrinsic semiconductors are nothing but adding some impurity to intrinsic semiconductor, we are getting extrinsic semiconductors, right? So here silicon germanium is an example. Here silicon germanium, whatever, adding some impurities like phosphorus, boron, arsenic, antimony, like that. I hope you got the points here. And whatever we are mixing the impurity, know that process is called doping. That process is called doping. So what is doping then? Doping is the process of mixing of impurities to the intrinsic semiconductor to get more conductivity. And you can say intrinsic semiconductors are added by some impurities so that we get a more conductivity. That process is called doping. Doping is a process of mixing of intrinsic semiconductor with some impurity to get more conductivity. So those process is called doping. And whatever the impurity we are adding now, this phosphorus, boron, these impurities are called dopant. What those are called, guys? Dopant. Remember this. This impurity is called dopant, and the process of adding impurity to the silicon. Silicon means what? Intrinsic semiconductor. Process of adding impurity to the intrinsic semiconductor to increase conductivity is called doping. And the impurity added is called dopant. I hope you got the points here. This is regarding intrinsic semiconductor and extrinsic semiconductor. What is intrinsic semiconductor? Intrinsic semiconductor is nothing but semiconductivity exhibited by solids due to pure semiconductor is called intrinsic semiconductivity, and the material or the element is called intrinsic semiconductor. What about extrinsic semiconductivity? The semiconductivity exhibited by adding some impurities to the intrinsic semiconductor, those are called extrinsic semiconductivity, and the element or the solids are called extrinsic semiconductors. So the process of adding impurity to the intrinsic semiconductor to get more conductivity is called doping, and the impurities added is called dopant. Remember this point. You may get whatever the point here. Again, by adding 15th group impurity, or you are going to add a 13th group impurity, or else you are going to add a 5 valence impurity, or you are going to add a 3 valent or trivalent impurity, depending upon that, extrinsic semiconductors are again classified into two types. One is N-type semiconductor, another one is P-type semiconductor. Depending upon the impurities added in extrinsic semiconductor, again extrinsic semiconductor are classified into two categories. One is N-type semiconductors, another one is P-type semiconductor. We'll discuss that. That is also a very important concept. Yes, we'll discuss. See here, guys, N-type semiconductor and P-type semiconductor. I told you, in extrinsic semiconductor, depending upon which impurity you are adding, either you are going to add a pentavalent impurity or you are going to add a trivalent impurity, depending upon that, again two classification in extrinsic semiconductors. What are those? N-type semiconductor and P-type semiconductors. So what are n-type semiconductor? See here. By looking at the picture, you come to know silicon is doped with or mixed with phosphorus impurity. See here, I will round it this one. Phosphorus. This is an impurity. You know already. Sorry, I have forgotten to write silicon here. What is the valency of silicon? Yes. Silicon is tetravalent. Silicon is carbon family, comes under. So therefore, silicon has 4 valence electron. And what about phosphorus? Phosphorus is nitrogen family. Therefore, phosphorus is having 5 valence electrons. That means 4 electrons of phosphorus are making covalent bond with silicon. An extra electron left here. In phosphorus, an extra electron left. Why? Because phosphorus is pentavalent. That means phosphorus contains 5 valence electron. Silicon contains 4 valence electron. So 4 electrons of phosphorus are making bond with, covalent bond with 4 silicon. See here 1, 2, 3, 4 bond. Now extra electron is remaining in phosphorus, right? Due to this extra electron, these electron can jump in the crystal. Therefore, due to electron movement, there is a pre electron. Therefore, conduction of electricity. N-type semiconductors, intrinsic extrinsic semiconductor in that N-type semiconductor. Are you getting, guys? So here, electron, extra electron on left, those extra electron can jump, can move in the crystal, and then hence they conduct electricity. That means, what is N-type semiconductors? N-type semiconductors are nothing but semiconductors in which impurity having extra valency or higher valency than the host atom are added to the solids. Semiconductivity exhibited by the solids due to adding an impurity of higher valency than the host atom. So such type of semiconductors are called N-type semiconductors. I hope you got the points here. So due to this extra higher valency than the host atom. Host atom means actually what is the intrinsic semiconductor we taken here? Silicon. That is host atom. We are added phosphorus and impurity. That is having extra valence electron, extra valency than the host atom. Due to that, whatever the conductivity exhibited, therefore that is called N-type semiconductors. What about P-type now? See, by looking at the picture only you come to know. Again, you know silicon is tetravalent. Silicon is carbon family. Therefore, silicon contains 4 valence electrons. What about boron? Boron is trivalent. Boron contains only 3 valence electrons. That means boron can able to form only 3 covalent bond with neighboring atoms. See here. 1, 2, 3. 3 covalent bonds are over. This silicon, see here. 1, 2, 3 bonds are there. But silicon contains 4 valence electrons. Therefore, again here extra valence electron in there in silicon. But what about boron? Boron will not have an electron to bond with silicon. Therefore, boron has some empty space here. Those are called holes. What these are called, guys? Holes. Holes are considered as a positive in nature. Okay, empty space. Because 3 valence electrons of boron are making a bond with 3 valence electrons of silicon. Now, fourth, whatever position is there, no, that remains empty. That is called a positive hole. So, as a result, this electron move here, the hole is created here. Again, this electron move here, hole is created here. Like that, hole can move from one place to another place. If hole can move from one place to another place, again, they conduct electricity. Due to the movement of the hole, they conduct electricity. Due to the movement of the electron, they conduct electricity. Are you getting? Therefore, due to moment of the electron, electrons are negative in charge. Therefore, the name N-type. N means negative. Due to electronic. Here, due to hole moment, they will get a conductivity. The holes are positive in nature. Positive means P. Therefore, P-type semiconductors. I hope you got the points here. Then what about definition of P-type semiconductor? P-type semiconductors are the solids whose conductivity can be increased by adding suitable elements of lower valency than the host atom. lower valency than the host atom. What is host atom? Silicon. What is the valency of silicon? 4. We are added a impurity here, boron. What is the valency of boron? 3. Are you getting, guys? Lower than the host atom. Here, silicon is host atom. What is the valency of silicon? 4. Phosphorus is impurity. What is the valency of phosphorus? 3. Sorry. How much? 5. Then higher than that of the host atom, lower than that of the host atom. Can you define now N-type and P-type semiconductor? N-type semiconductors are the solids whose conductivity is increased by adding suitable impurities of higher valency than the host atom are called N-type semiconductors. P-type semiconductors are the solids whose conductivity is increased by adding suitable impurities of lower valency than the host atom are called P-type semiconductors. I hope you got the points here. Remember these pictures. If you got the pictures, definitely you are going to understand what is N-type semiconductor and P-type semiconductor. Now we'll discuss difference between N-type semiconductors and P-type semiconductors. First one, you write definition. So, what is definition, guys, here? I told you just now. What is that? N-type semiconductors are the semiconductors or solids whose conductivity is increased by adding suitable impurity of higher valency than the host atom. Here, lower valency than the host atom. Next one. Here, electrons are charge carriers. Electrons are the charge carriers. That means due to electronic movement, they will conduct electricity. But what about P-type? Here, holes are the charge carriers. Holes are charge carriers. Yes. Electrons are the charge carriers. Holes are the charge carriers. Next one. Here, I will told you as earlier, impurity of what? Higher valency than the host atom is added. Impurity, yes, with higher valency than host atom. Impurity of higher valency than the host atom is added. Here, impurity with, yes, impurity with lower valency than host atom is added. Lower valency than host atom is added. Is added. I hope you got the point here. Impurity with higher valency than host atom is added. Impurity with lower valency than host atom is added. Here I told you, in here impurity is phosphorus, arsenic, antimony. Here impurity is boron. Remember. Okay. Here pentavalent impurities are added. Here trivalent impurities are added. Phosphorus is pentavalent. Boron is trivalent. Pentavalent impurities are added. Trivalent impurities are added. 15th group impurities are added. 13th group impurities are added here. So these are the difference between N-type semiconductors and P-type semiconductor. Very important concept. Now only one concept left in solid, that is magnetic properties of solid, that we are going to discuss in the next class. So, just last concept, magnetic properties of solids. After that, we will discuss last 5-year questions, whatever the questions asked in last 5-year previous question papers that we are going to discuss now. If you have any doubts, please comment below. If you are not getting anything, please go through the video once. You will definitely come to know. Thanks for watching. Thank you.